slavery was a legal institution in North America. From the beginning before the founding of the United States to the end of the Civil War, and passing of the 13th Amendment, slavery was a form of unfree labor. In 1619, the first Africans were purchased and imported from Africa to the English colony of Virginia. This practice was used earlier by Spanish in mid-16th century. Not all slaves were African. In the early years of the colonies, many Irish, Scots, and Germans were brought to the New World by way of indentured servitude. An indentured servant was typically a young, unskilled laborer who came to America under contract to work for an employer for a fixed period of time, typically 3 to 7 years, in exchange for their ocean transportation, food, clothing, and housing, and other necessities while serving as an indentured servant. Massachusetts is the first colony in North America to legalize slavery. 2 years later, the New England Confederacy of Plymouth, Massachusetts, Connecticut, and New Haven put into action a fugitive slave law. Black slaves and black and white indentured servants banded together with Nathaniel Bacon to participate in Bacon's Rebellion. This led to many more slave laws. In 1680, Virginia prohibited blacks from congregating in large numbers, bearing arms, and mandated harsh punishment for slaves who assaulted white Christians or attempted to escape. 2 years later, Virginia declared all imported slaves are slaves for life. Rice cultivation is introduced into Carolina. This increase in rice makes the demand for labor spike, especially slave labor. This increases the slave importation dramatically. In the early 18th century, from about 1705 to 1712, the colonies established many slave laws that restricted blacks. An example of these is when Virginia declared all non-Christian servants to be slaves. It defines all slaves as real estate, acquits masters who kill slaves during punishment, and forbids slaves and free color peoples from physically assaulting white people. The slaves from Carolina start fleeing to Florida. This happens because the Spanish declare that all runaway slaves will not be sold or returned. Spanish Florida then promises land to all runaway slaves from British colonies. The slaves in Santo, South Carolina, hearing the promises by the Spanish rebel. They sack the town, burn down the armory, and kill many whites. A colonial militia puts an end to the rebellion before they can reach Florida.
In the early days of the Revolutionary War, pre-1776, blacks and whites participated in interracial mobs to protest injustices from the Stamp Act of 1765 to the Boston Massacre. Some historians even speculate that the first man to be killed at the Boston Massacre was in fact a free black man. During the Revolutionary War, only 25,000 of the 500,000 blacks in the colonies were free. Of these, many did fight against the British. Slaves participated in many revolutionary battles on both sides. After the Revolutionary War, many Africans battled for their freedom. These the words of the Declaration of Independence for the defense. They hoped that men who wrote such lofty words as all men are created equal would realize the immorality of continuing to enslave their fellow countrymen. We expect great things, one group wrote, from men who have made such a noble stand against the designs of the fellow man to enslave them. However, the American Revolution and the American colonies fight against the British oppression did not bring slavery to an end. In 1787, the United States declared slavery illegal in the Northwest Territory. A year later, the U.S. Congress ratifies the Constitution and cannot ban slavery until 1808. Slavery has a mixed response throughout the states. New York passes a slaves law stating slaves are slaves for life. While states like Connecticut and Massachusetts forbid residents from participating in the slave trade. All these lead up to Congress banning the slave trade in 1808. As the U.S. went into the industrial age of the 1800s, new inventions made the demand for slave labor more great. The cotton gin was the most pivotal of these inventions. It was invented in 1793 by a man named Eli Whitney. The cotton gin made the picking of cotton and the process of taking seeds out easier and faster. This made cotton a key crop in the South. Due to this sudden rise in cotton manufacturing, slave labor became increased greatly. In the same year, the government passed the first fugitive slave law. This law allowed slave owners to cross state lines to capture runaway slaves and made it a penal offense to aid any runaways.
In 1803, the U.S. buys the Louisiana Territory from France. Around this time, many cities are building new ports in their cities for the slave trade. The U.S. prohibits the importation of slaves from foreign territories into Louisiana.
By the 1820s, slavery is looking for more room to expand into the West. But like most times in our country, the great minds of the U.S. settled down and made a compromise. And in 1820, the Missouri Compromise did that. It forbid the slavery in the Louisiana Territory north of Missouri's southern border. Also under its terms, Maine was admitted as a free state, and Missouri as a slave state. This made the balance between slave and free states the same. Then at the end of the 1820s, the abolition movement started to gain steam. In 1829, David Walker publishes his widely read condemnation of slavery, an appeal to the Carter citizens of the world. 2 years later, William Lloyd Garrison begins to publish The Liberator. It is a weekly newspaper that advocates for the complete abolition of slavery. Because of this, William Lloyd Garrison becomes one of the most important men in the abolitionist movement.
In the same year that The Liberator came out, one of the biggest slave rebellions took place. Nat Turner, an enslaved preacher, meets free and enslaved blacks to rebel in Southampton, Virginia. This rebellion is also known as the Southampton Insurrection. It is the most significant slave uprising in U.S. history. The rebels kill upward of 60 white people. The rebellion is short-lived though, and Nat Turner is eventually captured after evading capture for some time. Ultimately though, he is tried and hanged.
As the years pass, the anti-slavery movement builds speed. In 1837, New York hosted the first anti-slavery society convention. Then, New York City hosts the first convention of the Anti-Slavery Society of American Women, an event attended by both black and white women. Pennsylvania then hosts the second convention in Philadelphia a year later.
As the battle over slavery enraged, many Northerners tried to halt the spread of slavery. In 1846, David Wilmot, a representative from Pennsylvania, put forth the Wilmot Proviso in Congress. It wanted to make all territory gained from the Mexican War free. It was blocked by Southerners, who continued to inflame the debate over slavery.
By 1850, California, Utah, and New Mexico are applying for admission to the Union. The battle where slavery should be legal in these states is decided in the Compromise of 1850. The Compromise admits California as a free state and leaves Utah and New Mexico up to popular sovereignty. It also makes a new and more straitened fugitive slave law and bans the slave trade in Washington, D.C.
In the decade leading up to the Civil War, the battle over slavery will grow increasingly and ultimately explode into the Civil War. In 1852, Harriet Beecher Stowe publishes her abolitionist book, Uncle Tom's Cabin. This is the most influential book to stir anti-slavery sentiment. Then, 2 years later, in 1854, Congress passes the Kansas-Nebraska Act. This establishes the territory of Kansas and Nebraska
and repeals the Compromise of 1820. This leads to more tension and events that lead to bloody Kansas and the violence there.
Then, in 1857, the Supreme Court rules in the Dred Scott case that Congress does not have the right to ban slavery in states and that slaves are not citizens. These are the actions that happened before, and then the election of 1860, the South was done. With the secession of the South Carolina in 1861, followed by the rest of the South, then the Confederate States of America is born, and Jefferson Davis is elected.
The Civil War has now begun. As the war goes on, Congress bans slavery in all the states and their territories. Both armies draft black slaves to fight for them. As the war rages on for a year, the North's victory at the Battle of Gettysburg leads to President Lincoln signing the Emancipation Proclamation. Although this freed all slaves in the South, none were really free as Southerners didn't follow Lincoln's law.
The following scene is a dramatization of actual events.
After another 2 years of fighting, the North is victorious over the South in the Civil War. As the South is reinstituted into the Union, Congress passes the 13th Amendment, which frees all slaves and makes slavery illegal in the United States. Although slavery is illegal, blacks will still face discrimination all the way up until the 1960s. African Americans are now very prosperous. This is Morgan Freeman.